So, how long have you been gaming?
I'm 40 years old, and let's see, my earliest memories were of like a pre-kind of home console with like the Pong units and the hunting units that would have like a light rifle attached to a game where a deer would bounce across the screen, you know, and you'd shoot it with the rifle, you know, and maybe there's a couple other games built in, like Pongs or something, you know, these really old pre-cartridge systems. The shuttle crashed over East Texas, and I, in a week or two, like scored 160,000. And I thought, is that a high score? You know, is that the high score? I wonder what the high score of Donkey Kong is. And the internet, you know, had been around for a few years, obviously, at that point. I go online and I look at the world records, and 160,000 was like ranked number 8 at the time or something like that. So I was like, hey, that was a pretty good score, but there are much better people than me. And that was the Twin Galaxy site. And I'm not sure who was the leader at that point, but 160,000 is nothing now, you know, to those people. But I was impressed, and that's kind of how I discovered the Twin Galaxies. You know, King of Kong's and Chasing Ghosts Beyond the Arcade, especially King of Kong's, did a lot to get classic gaming culture out there. But the people involved are fascinating people, but they're kind of goofy, and like so am I. But they're people could identify with Steve Weeb. He's an everyman, you know. But they're, most people in that film are more eccentric than that. A la Billy Mitchell, and Billy Mitchell's the star of the show. He's a kind of pompous ass, you know, but he's incredible. The things that he's done, I admire him. It's wrestling. He knows when to be a heel. His playing is brilliant, and it wouldn't be anywhere as interesting as it is these days or that movie wouldn't be interesting without him. He's a star in a way, but that's not for everybody. But that movie is so good. It's, in my opinion, it's not really about gaming. It's man versus man. But I'm just not sure that the popular culture is... They remember classic gaming to a degree, but maybe we're just ghosts, you know, trapped in the arcade or something, you know? Like, maybe it's us. Maybe it's not them that's off. Maybe it's us.
Well, I'm in the car. I hear rumor that there are people lining up outside of buildings all over town for some game called Halo 4. I thought I would check up on this rumor and go find these people. Come with me. All right, okay, so we're here at Best Buy. Halo 4 is hours away. You've been here hours already. What time did you say you got out here?
8:20.
8:20. How long you been waiting for Halo 4 to come on out?
Since 2007.
And, you know, midnight releases, I know how it is as well. But
cold. Cold, lonely, and tired.
Now, are you, when you get the game, are you going to go home and fire it up right away?
I'm going to probably go to bed.
Now, when you got here, did you expect to, were you disappointed to see a gentleman here ahead of you?
No. I figured that there would already be a bunch of people here before me. It's every time I get here, I'm usually here, get to show up around 10:30, 11. But this year I got here at like 9:30. I wonder if there'd be anybody here or not. But I just came, you know, just to hang out until it releases. That'd be cool to get an early spot.
Are you going to be playing in as soon as you get home?
I'm debating. I probably will. I got class in the morning, but I'm probably going to play it anyways because I've been waiting for it since 2007 like this guy.
What time did y'all get out here for this?
3:20. In the afternoon.
And I take it y'all aren't gonna go to sleep when you get home, huh?
No. Probably not for the next couple of days.
Yeah, no, not for a couple of days at least.
We'll be surviving off of rations and monster.
And monster.
Yeah, I see there's already been some Breakfast of Champions things going on.
Oh yeah. We gotta fuel up.
It's like Mountain Dew all over the place. So.
Monster, Mountain Dew, and Doritos.
Yeah. Oh my god, yeah.
Ben Gold is a 16-year-old high school sophomore at Green Hill School in Dallas. He's a nice, normal kid who happens to be very good in mathematics, plays on his high school baseball team, and plays video games. He plays video games some more, and some more. In fact, he's a champion video player who holds the world's record for the highest score on Stargate. It took him some 35 hours and 50 minutes to accumulate 40,001,150 points when he set the record in September. Benny has also traveled all over the country as a video game celebrity and has kept in touch with friends in the international video game community. All of this, mind you, at his own expense.
See, I've got everything figured out that when you take the game, the actual games that I played, or when I, you know, from when I first started playing, all the plane tickets and everything, and my long distance phone bill, which is very horrendous now. To break even, you know, I would need probably to make $5,000, which I think I can do.
But even if he doesn't make all that money back, Ben Gold has achieved a certain celebrity status.
There's going to be professional video game players. People are going to start making money off of them.
And you want to be there?
Oh, I want to be in the middle of it.
Kind of have that cycle starting again right now. You have people because of MLG, and some other organizations that, and they're actually convinced that this is it. This is the next thing. They're about to start making the big bucks. This whole pro gaming thing is about to explode and be their livelihood. Just like the NFL, just like, you know, Major League Baseball. What advice would you have, being probably, you know, or easily, certainly, the first group of gamers to ever go through believing that at one point in time as well? What advice would you have for the people right now who they're kind of, some of them are kind of banking on that happening?
That's a hard thing to say, because back in the day, I mean, when I played 3 hours a day after school, I was considered this radical kid that was going to be, I mean, I come home, I did my homework, maybe be done by 4:30, 5 o'clock, or get done with the sport, go to the arcade, and it closed at 9. And I mean, that was, parents were outraged that my parents would let me do that. So today, you know, that's very tame. And so it's hard to say, because today, to become a competitive gamer, it's a 24/7 thing. I mean, it's, and so the amount of dedication, the amount of resources needed is far greater than what it was back when I was playing. And so it's hard for me to give advice to someone, because if it's their passion, they love it, and they're playing on a team, and they really want to be the best. But now there's going to be the competition is intense, and so for every person, for every fatality there is, there's probably 10,000 or 20,000 fatality want-to-be's. And just to keep that in perspective, just like for every Roger Staubach or Troy Aikman there is, there's 20,000 people that wanted to be that person. And there's some people that kind of make it to the minor leagues, and there's a couple that make it to the pros, but they get knocked out. And so I always say have a balance. You know, that's something that's very important. And regardless, like when I talk to Billy or Steve Sanders or a lot of my friends, this is the most important thing. I tell this to Richie, his family.
Richie Knuckles,
yeah. Every time I talk to him, I said, Richie, family. That's what the most important thing is. That's what matters. And, you know, I think I said this in one of the articles, nobody's gonna remember me on my tombstone that I got $40 million on Stargate. You know, that's not what's gonna be written there. So I think it's important to keep a perspective. And you know what? If this is not gonna be the sport, if the professional gaming is not gonna be your thing, to recognize, to have something else that's there that you're passionate about. I mean, I just simply transferred my passion. I went from baseball cards to video games, and then I went to mathematics, then I went into foreign languages, traveling, politics. If you take that passion and put it into something else, just that's what the most important thing is.
Getting down in the 30s here in Denton, Texas, and I'm heading out anyway. I hear there's this game all the kids are playing now called Call of Duty Black Ops 2. I'm heading out to find a couple people waiting in line to get the game, and gonna get in line myself or freeze to death first. So let's do this thing. Another game.
Yep.
Y'all are out here again.
Mm-hmm. Of course.
So I gotta ask, Black Ops 2 coming out this close to Halo 4, which one's gonna get most of your attention?
Woo!
As you get photobombed.
I like Call of Duty more than Halo. I own a PS3.
Call of Duty!
But Halo was really good. I played it. It was really, really good. It's gonna be close.
Well, out of curiosity, do you think the manufacturer is putting out these AAA titles this close together every time of year, or this time of year every year, hurts them?
No, I don't think so. I think big fans buy both games and play them both.
Was the Halo one?
Yeah,
leftover from Halo.
All right.
Get to some of the more fun items, but it's cool. The Atari football is my buddy Mike's Atari football, which he bought in high school, or he traded in his comic book collection to get one, and that's actually the second one he owned, because the first one was taken over by a cat and its babies and lived inside of it and destroyed it. So he wanted another one, then he got married. His wife wanted it out of the house, I'm sure, and I gladly stepped up to store it for him, and I hope it gets, you know, put to some use.
I'm trying to fall down in your garage.
Yeah, she's
just lost her over in here. Let's see what we got in here, man. Atari 7800,
right?
All sealed.
Yeah.
But I like that there's Look at it. We got a contest here. The Atari Advantage. Collect games, win prizes. See inside for details. The mystery remains.
Yeah.
We still don't know what the details are. I'm actually really curious about this shelf over here.
It's, I think that's all computer nonsense.
Video game ROM emulator, Dreamcast ROM.
Oh, those are just, yeah, all Sony PlayStation, all Dreamcast. See, this is bad. You could probably be showing this or whatever. But...
what the heck is this guy?
Double Dragon.
Oh, yeah, yeah, Double Dragon Jammer. That'll go in the... I don't even remember.
Yeah.
So I worked at TI and that was being tossed out and I couldn't let it just go in the garbage.
Don't mess with Texas. Yeah. Instruments. Random crap.
Sorry, some of it's not even game related, but the TV classic. Games that came out that were kind of neat emulations or recreations of the
here we go.
You film me and I film you. Okay, this is I think all Sega Saturn. Oh, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna have to hand these out to you.
All right, and back it up, get a whole thing. We're gonna start spreading these out.
You know, yeah, let's just do the work here.
Yeah.
Okay, this is really cool. These Sega Master System cartridges are exceptional because those are the ones that came in the display units at the stores. And I remember one day we were at the Collin Creek Mall and Dillard's had a Master System display. They were shutting down or something for some reason. And I asked the guy what they were going to do with the cartridges. And he said they'd sell them to me for almost nothing. And I expanded my Master System collection. Kind of in a neat way.
Well, these are actually very interesting. Master System did this.
Those silly cards. They
had the cartridges, but they had some that just came out on these little cards. Which, I mean, nowadays, kids are going to look at this and go, oh, big deal, that thing's 10 times bigger than my SD card, you know.
Yeah, or their NDS.
But back then, this was a big deal. Look at that. It was like a little credit card size thing and played a video game. I actually liked Ghost House.
Yeah. The NES Advantage.
Yeah, yeah.
That thing, it was a terrific joystick. No doubt about it. I never used the weird pausing or slowdown functionality of it, but otherwise it was such a rock solid.
Well, I mean, it's really similar to their arcade stick at the time too. Yeah. So, you know, I mean, you know, to some people this seemed like a really weird way to control a video game at the time. Because all we had before that, really as far as anything that was popular, was joysticks. Oh my god! He's trying to dig through it like a puppy dog or something. Yeah. And he's like, and he starts doing the Daniel Bryan, yes. And I'm just curious, I'd love to find that kid today. Nintendo 64 kid, if you're out there, I'm sorry for the bad impression. I just want to know if you really liked it as much as you thought you would. Okay, thanks. I like this one right here. Check this out. Pac-Man Light Switch Play. $1.
Still in the blister pack.
Still in the blister pack. This is for the younger set, way before there was Angry Birds everything in
right.
The local Target store. There was Pac-Man everything. If this isn't an example of that, eat this Angry Birds.
One of the classic Atari catalogs. Who knows what that
is?
Paint sample?
This is a Polaroid of Pitfall.
Oh, okay. I must have beat the game or something as a kid and took a picture of it.
Yeah, check that out. It's a Polaroid of Pitfall. It's definitely not the best quality. I can't tell what your score is, but... What, did you maybe take this to send in, try to send in to Activision
and
maybe never did?
Yeah.
There's a little piece. That's a one-of-a-kind piece right there, for sure.
I have a problem completing projects, so that probably accurately describes what happened. There's the Atari Force pack in comic books, you know, that would come with Defender and a few of the titles, you know. Those are interesting. Gorp. I think that came with a weird app controller add-on, I imagine. And the Miss Pac-Man was a terrific port, in my opinion, for its time.
Well, it should. The people that had made the add-on kit were the ones that made the port. So it should.
I didn't know that. I was aware of that.
Here we go.
This is really good for it.
Old school, baby, right there. And then even, and we talked about, now, I don't know if the camera get a good zoom in on this. This is what we used to have to play with remote control controllers.
Oh, the RF adapter unit.
No, look at that thing.
Yeah.
Andre the Giant couldn't play with that thing comfortably, yeah. Man. And those are the telescoping antennas. It's like a set of rabbit ears that would come out the back of the things, man. It was insane.
Yeah, it was like designed for Nosferatu or something. Long fingers.
I mean, it was just, yeah, you had that gigantism to comfortably play the game. No, this I find interesting, a Data Age catalog.
Yeah, those games are kind of rare. I'm trying to think which what the name of the game was. Warplock, I think that's the one I had.
There we go, right there. You got the Warplock cartridge right there. It's a pretty uncommon piece,
I
man.
I have these books out.
Uh-oh.
Just so I could draw some of the imagery from the games.
Okay, now this is rare in just for the fact that this actually tries to explain the object of this game. Well, look at this. Maze crazy. They would try to tell stories with these. They couldn't tell on the screen at the time.
Sure.
And I think this one, world famous comedian Gallagher, I think he was caught running around. He robbed. Tell me that doesn't look like Gallagher.
Yeah, it's like Keystone Gallagher's.
Yeah. First of all, I got Super Cobra, which was a... I always really laugh at... Let's see if they use the same... terminology they did in the arcade version. This one said that, you know, basically you... Yeah, there we go. When you reach level 11, the object is to pick up the booty. That's actually the object of the game.
It usually is.
It's full of Nintendo DS stuff. I love the Nintendo DS. And supported it greatly. And then wound up kind of hacking the thing with one of those ROM cards and
playing it even more. But there's a Virtual Boy there.
Oh, there it is.
Picked up, I think, like at a Target because, you know, they weren't on the shelves long. And I think word went on the street that they had them at Target for $14.99 on closeout or something. And
they're certainly worth more than that now. Yeah.
You see?
I tried to get a good shot of the poster.
Uh-huh.
It's a little bit hard because of the handicapped people.
Yeah.
Is there maybe a better place the poster could have gone?
Nah. Like right at that window.
Yeah, like that window right there. I mean,
that's originally where it's supposed to be.
The door,
but the sun glares in so hard during the day that we put it over there instead. Our store gets baked in the afternoon as far as the sunlight goes. Not drugs, but so I was like,
oh, yo, well, I mean, so says the guy with the big box of Doritos.
Kind of personal.
This is not the best place for an on switch.
Right.
Oh, I have to twist it even worse. There we go. Oh, he likes it now.